program features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
To the vast, enormous wilderness where we can take you on a live safari journey that you can experience Africa as you never have before. This is Safari Live.
Ready. Standing by.
You are live. Hello and welcome on our Sunset Safari, where you can get to go on a live safari from the middle of the African bush and learn all kinds of amazing things about the incredible creatures that call this place home. My name is Jamie and the gentleman behind the camera is Rion. Vast and beautiful wilderness that we are sitting in. So we're sitting in this safari tent where we get to show you all kinds of exciting things, skulls of animals, different types of beetles under the microscope, and all kinds of exciting things in between. And soon you will meet a Taylor and you will meet FW, who are out on the vehicles to show you some of the bigger, more interesting mammal life that's still wandering around, and birds and reptiles and all sorts of things in between. Now we're on a place called Juma Private Game Reserve, which is in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa. So right up in the top northeastern corner of South Africa. And a very, very warm welcome to all of the students watching at Kingston Elementary. I hope you're all very, very excited to be going on a live safari. There is so much that we have to show you and teach you, and I'm sure you've all got lots and lots of questions that you want to ask. And because this is happening right here and right now, for you guys, it's the morning, but for us here in Africa, it is the afternoon. And what you're seeing is happening right here in real life. And what that means is you've got to imagine that you're here with us, and that means that you can have a conversation with us. You can send through your questions. Maybe there's something you've always wanted to know about lions or elephants or leopards or antelope, anything like that. And we'll be looking at a lot of different things. Now, first things first, how many of you are scared of spiders? Hands up if you're scared of spiders. Now, you shouldn't be scared of spiders because they're actually very, very, very useful little creatures. But I have something to show you that might make some of you feel a little bit scared and a little bit squeamish. And here she is. Isn't she beautiful? This is known as a solifuge. And so she's actually not a spider at all, but something completely different and a nocturnal creature. Now, very sadly, this little female is probably at the end of her life. So they have relatively short lives. They don't live forever. This one we found outside one of the bedrooms in the camp that we live in, because we live right here in the middle of the bush. Now, you might be saying, oh, that's very scary. And perhaps she is, if you don't know any better. She is very, very fast. And at some point, we're going to stop and have a look at her under the microscope in the next few minutes. She is very, very fast. She comes out at night. She looks very scary and hairy, but they are completely, completely harmless, so they can't hurt you at all. They might give you a little bit of a bite, a little bit of a nip, but it's not going to do you any harm at all. We'll discuss her a little bit more in a moment, but for now, let's go over to FW, who also has something hairy, but much bigger.
Good afternoon. We have got James's family with us. The baboons. Lucky tried walking towards those Nyala this morning on bushwalk. Hopefully they won't go past Inga's again and decide to have a beer or two. Afternoon, everyone. My name is FW. And with me on camera, I've got Brian and the Thumb. Brian, who's the Thumb this afternoon?
The Zombie Thumb.
The Zombie Thumb. Wonder what these baboons are getting up to. I wonder if they're going to drink water. Maybe we should go reposition at the water, wait for them to come through. Yeah, let's take a chance. See if they want to spend some more time with us. So yeah, after we finish with these baboons, let's see what they get up to first, and then we're gonna head over to Cheetah Plains, see if we can get lucky with some cheetah this afternoon. Brian says he hasn't seen cheetah in a long time, so let's hope. Let's see if we can find them. Try and give these baboons as much space as possible that they don't run off in the other direction. I've got a tendency of doing that. Noah, you're asking what the rarest animal is that I've seen. I think probably pangolin that I've been fortunate enough to spend a tiny bit of time with. Yeah, scaly anteater is another name for it. Mostly nocturnal, you see them at night time moving around. But yeah, quite a special sighting. Let's see if we can get another glimpse at these baboons. They're already changing direction. Let's try. Yeah, they are right in front of us. Don't be shy, man. Camilla, I think with the weather and how it affects the animals, the baboons might not have minded it at all. That would have given them a lot more time to move around, try and find some food. So they might have enjoyed the whole wet, colder weather. There would be a lot of activity with termites and stuff along with the rain, and that would have been a good source of protein. So they would have enjoyed it. How nice is that little baby hitchhiking on mum's back? Taking, it looks like a white berry bush eating some fruits there. Baboons and their temperament. And Nash would like to know if baboons are calm or can they be quite vicious. I think a bit of both. If needs be, they can be very vicious. Males, when they're fighting, can be quite vicious, and yeah, big male baboon you don't want to really get into a fight with. It's got massive canine teeth that it'll use to protect itself, but generally speaking they're quite laid back and just carry on, do their thing. But definitely something that you won't want to push into a corner and have a full-on confrontation. I think a lot of people are probably more scared of them than maybe leopard or lion sometimes. Those white berry bush fruits are actually nice. They're quite good to eat. And yeah, if we had to, we could also eat it. Vina, you asking if I've ever seen a monkey attack another animal? No, I haven't. I've never seen that. I've just heard all the stories of male baboons taking impala and young impala. so you get a bit of protein. Alright, I think we're going to leave these baboons to do their thing. We're going to carry on to our quest to Cheetah Plains. In the meantime, let's go say hello to Taylor.
Good afternoon. It's very sunny here today in South Africa. It's quite wonderful, as you can, of course, see. A couple of clouds that are sheltering us from the sun this afternoon. Now, my name is Taylor, and on camera with me is David, who's got a number of different nicknames. And for all of you that are watching from Kingston Elementary, hello and welcome, and I hope that you've got lots and lots of questions to ask us. But I've got two birds to show you. Now, maybe you've seen something like this before. You get Egyptian geese all over the world. But unfortunately, they have come to South Africa and they are now a pest because they will go around and destroy all the grasslands, especially the golfers. The golfers don't like the Egyptian geese at all because they make such a mess on the fairways and the golfing greens. But we like them out here. We like all animals, even the creepy crawlies that Jamie is going to show you today in the tent. We like those ones too. But you can see Egyptian geese do not trust us this afternoon. They are giving us a little bit of a death stare. And they'll spend most of their day going in and out of the water. Maybe they'll find a nice green patch of grass to feed on, and then they'll come back in for a little dip again. And it goes like that for pretty much most of the day. But we're looking for something very exciting this afternoon, and I hope you're ready, and hopefully we manage to find them in time while we've still got a bit of time to spend with you. But we are looking for two leopard cubs. Now, we've checked a couple of roads and we haven't picked up on any sign of them. We're looking for footprints now, or even the leopards themselves. So we came to check around this little pan because there's a little boy leopard and his name is Hosana. And he absolutely loves the water. Well, he likes to catch the things that live in the water. So like terrapins, which are like a little turtle, I suppose, and even if there's catfish. And at the moment, he's showing quite a bit of interest in frogs too. So that's quite funny and interesting to see. So we always come and check around here to make sure if he's not maybe hiding somewhere. But luckily we've got Herbert helping us, and I think Rexon is going to help us too this afternoon find these leopards. So we've got lots and lots of eyes and ears. And even as you are sitting in your classroom, you can help David and I look for the leopards too. But they are very, very difficult to spot because their pattern on their coat allows them to blend into the vegetation very well. Hello, Hannah. You wondering if we go up to the animals, if they are not dangerous? It depends on what the animal is feeling. So like you and I, sometimes we are sad, sometimes we are happy, sometimes we are a little bit irritated. The animals can feel like that too. So the most important thing about our job is that you are able to study animal, learn animal behavior, because a lion, a leopard, an elephant won't just be angry with you. It will tell you if it's having a bad day or not, and then you can act accordingly. So we try not to go up to them. Normally we'll let them come to us, it depends. But we really won't try and walk too close to the animals. In the vehicles, they don't see us as people, so they're not as frightened of us. And then sometimes we're very lucky and we're able to get close. Now I can hear some chatter on the radio, and we use these radios to talk to each other. So we're gonna quickly ask Herbert if he has an update for us. Herbie for Taylor, any updates? Right, nothing just yet. So Herbert has just managed to find some tracks of the two little leopard cubs. So we're going to go back across to where Herbie is and see if we can give him a hand that side, and hopefully we'll find these leopards. But we're going to go back to the tent with Jamie, who's apparently got some baboons to show you.
I have
have the part of what used to be a baboon. It is now very unfortunately a deceased baboon. So sorry if I gave some of you a little bit of a fright. However, it does provide us with an amazing opportunity to have a look at what a baboon skull looks like. Now, this baboon died of natural causes, but you can see that very, very long face. Now, I know that some of you were asking FW about stories about baboons or monkeys, if they could ever be vicious or aggressive creatures. Now, they're not aggressive, and no animal out here, like a human being, is naturally aggressive, but they are very, very protective of their families or their troops, particularly a male baboon. Male baboons have a very, very important job to do. Now, I have seen male baboons chasing leopards away before, and that's something that we've actually seen on our live safari, leopards running away from a big male baboon. And a big male baboon is very, very large, and as you can see, has big, sharp canine teeth as large as a lion's. So they do have very, very strong canine teeth. The females aren't, they don't have such big teeth, but the males definitely do, and that's a defense mechanism against predators. Now, every baboon troop will most likely have more than one big male baboon. I've messed up this skull. There we go. Back together again. Every baboon troop will have more than one male baboon, and they will band together to protect the troop against anything that they see as a threat, and that includes human beings. And when I was a child, I was terrified of baboons, absolutely terrified. Now I love them and I respect them because I understand more about them, but that is definitely an animal that when I was a little girl, I found very, very scary, because what happens is baboons get very used to people very quickly, and they become sort of thugs of the bush. And if anybody doesn't look after their food properly, just like if you were to go hiking and you didn't put your food away from bears, baboons learn that people mean food, and then they go and they raid dustbins and so on, and they can get very, very aggressive if they don't get what they want. So I was chased on more than one occasion as a child. Oh, before we put him away, I just heard Ethan's question, and I don't want you to miss out on that. Ethan, you want to know how strong a baboon's jaw is. Now, Ethan, the longer an animal's jaw gets, generally with mammals, the less bite pressure they can actually exert. So it's not going to be as strong as a bite of a lion, which is very, very stocky, or a hyena that crushes bones. So if a lion can bite down with about 600 or so, 650 or so pounds of pressure, if I had to guess, I would say a baboon would probably be somewhere around 400 pounds of pressure. So still pretty strong, very, very strong. And remember, a human being can also bite down very hard. Not as hard as a lion or a leopard, for example, or a hyena or a crocodile, but pretty hard indeed. And a baboon is no different. Hard enough that it could, if it got you in the wrong place, it could do some really serious damage. But we're not scared of baboons anymore. I'm not scared of baboons anymore. It's just about treating them with respect and not leaving rubbish around. We're here in their home, so we don't want to leave any rubbish around that they can get hold of and learn that that's what human beings mean and that they associate us with food. I hear that Taylor's been showing you many feathered friends. I think we should go and see which one she has found.
Rightio, we're just trying to find this bird that was hopping around. There it is. You're very lucky to see this bird if it's going to decide to show itself to us. There's its head. This is called, and off it goes. That is called, or it was called, a grey-headed bushshrike. Let me go forward. I don't know if we're going to, I think it could have flown off. Maybe we get lucky. Are we lucky? It's not our lucky day, unfortunately. Let me have a look for a picture in my book so I can show you what they really look like. Now, you see, this is a very old book. I've had it for a couple of years, and it's got wet, and you can see it's held together by tape. I think most guides' bird books look like this. There's where I'm looking for it. I'm looking for it, and there we go. Gray-headed, 398. Gonna go to this page. No, we've got to go a little bit further that way. I've forgotten how to use my bird book. Here we go. Right, so we're looking at this one over here. So that is the bird that we just saw. And there is one calling in the distance, but it is very, very soft. I don't think you'll be able to hear it. But it's got a beautiful call, and it sounds like this. and it does that. And we call it a very special name in Afrikaans, which is a language that we speak down here. We call it the spookvoël, which means the ghost bird. And the reason why it's called the ghost bird is because we never see it. So that's why I said you're so lucky to spot that beautiful bird. Now, unfortunately, we haven't found the leopards yet, but we are still looking. And that's one of the things you have to do. You have to look for the animals. Megan, you were wondering how many animals do we see on a normal day? That's a really tough one, Megan. Sometimes we see lots and lots of animals. We can see lions, leopards, cheetah, elephants, buffalo, all the big five in one game drive, and even more. And then some days, you'll be lucky enough to spot a few impala. So it just depends on the day, I suppose, and how much luck you're having. Are you checking the right spots? And then it's something else that's very important is the weather and what's happening in the environment. What season it is? Is it winter? Is it summer? And if you know where there's lots of food and water, then you'll generally find a couple of animals. Even though there's lots of food and water around now, it's very thick. Now, nature wondering why that bird we just saw, the grey-headed bushrike, is so rare. It's not that it's necessarily rare, because there are lots and lots of those birds around. But what is so special about it is that you never get to see it, because it hides away. It's a very shy bird. But now we're looking at a red-billed hornbill, which is not a very shy bird, and you may recognize this character, and I'm sure you've all seen the movie. Do you remember the movie The Lion King? And there was a bird by the name of Zazu. This is, well, a very distant cousin of what Zazu is. There are no blue hornbills in Africa, so I'm not sure what species of hornbill Zazu really was, but we've just got a couple of other vehicles driving around here, so we're gonna move out quickly. Just going to pull off the road. We're on a big property, you see, 8.5 million acres of land. And there's lots of other people that are driving around here too. So that was Rexon. Rexon's helping us look for the leopard, and he's got all his guests on the back of the vehicle. So even though we're double checking roads now, sometimes it's very, very good because the animals can move. And I was saying that the vegetation is very thick. Oh, listen. Ah, David, you see where that hornbill landed on the top left? And then there's another bird just down to the right. Okay, go in there. Oh, we're trying to find, there's an orange breast. Can you hear that? That is the cousin of the grey-headed bushrike. I'm trying to see where it's jumping around. It's much smaller. Let me go forward, David. Let's see if we can get another look from here. But if we can see those two birds in one go, you are all the luckiest people. There it is. I found it. Are you ready, David? There's two of them, yep. And they're hopping. Going to have to be very sneaky. Also very shy. Do you see one, David? Yep. There, they're flying again. We're going to have to play catch up. Okay, I've got them. We've got them. David, on that fallen acacia. Can you see through there? Yeah, go up, 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 up. They're in there, there. They were. There we go. Go, David, go down to the left. There we go. Zoom straight in the middle. Go down to the left. There we go. There we go. See, this is a different one. You see how it's got an orange breast on its... I'm just turning the radio down, everyone's talking, but not a complete grey head. Oh, there's two of them. Oh my goodness, you are so lucky to see this. You are so, so, so lucky. You can see that's the female. The male has got the darker black eye stripe. He was hopping at the back. You are so lucky to see both bushrikes that we see in this area. The grey-headed first, much bigger, almost double the size. And then this one is my favourite one. The orange-breasted bushrike. And when it calls, it sounds like it's saying, coffee, tea and me, coffee, tea and me. See if you can make that call. Isn't that such a cool call? You're so lucky. And all of you at Kingston Elementary, I believe that you said that that is a beautiful bird. I cannot tell you. There are people that come from all over the world to come and see those two birds that we've just shown you in just a matter of minutes. I've got a good feeling about the safari this afternoon. I think we are going to be in store for a lot of lots and lots of animals today. If we've seen those two birds straight away, my goodness, that is so cool. David? Is that the best sighting of the orange-breasted? Ah, we found an abandoned vehicle. This is Herbert's vehicle, and he is out now tracking the leopard, so we're going to keep scratching around here. We must be getting close now. We must be getting close. Now, we might have to jump off and give Herbert a hand too. We're going to keep searching. So let's go back across to Jamie, who's in the tent and armed with microscope and amazing artifacts.
You are so lucky to have seen those birds with Taylor. And I've just been looking through my bird book and looking at all of the amazing different colored birds that we get here in Africa. But you can start learning birds about birds where you are at home in Virginia Beach. So all of you at Kingston Elementary, one of the things that we love to do is to teach you to get really, really excited, not just about lions and leopards and elephants, they're really cool too, but also things like birds. Now, where you are in Virginia Beach, you could see things like Canada geese, you could see pelicans, which we could get here, but it's very, very unlikely. Peregrine falcons, all kinds of really, really exciting birds, and possibly even snow geese, which I would love, love, love to see. So go out into your gardens, get a pair of binoculars, or even just walk out with a bird book or look up some of the birds on the internet and go and see what you can find. It's like a treasure hunt. And just as Taylor was showing you, sometimes looking for birds is difficult. You have to pay close attention. What is different? What is the same? Some species look very, very similar, but it's just a stripe across the eyes, for example, that makes them look different, or perhaps the colors of their wings. So go out and make a bird list. See which birds you can see and identify, and try and learn a little bit more about them. How do they build their nests? Because, of course, birds have a completely different approach to nest building. Different species build different nests. Like this tiny, tiny little nest, for example. See how it's barely the size of my hand? Now, this particular nest was built by a bird called a blue waxbill. And look how clever it's been. This is why birds are so amazing. We tend to look past them because we've all grown up with birds fluttering around. We're lucky because even if you're in a city, you get to see birds. But they're completely and utterly fascinating. And if you have a look at the way that this blue waxbill has built its web, let me try and keep it still. The blue waxbill has built its nest. Now that I'm trying to keep it still, it's wobbling even more. It has wrapped spider's webs around it. And it's wrapped, why do you think it would wrap spider's webs around it? Well, spider webs are very gluey. Those of you that have walked into spider webs before, very gluey, but also think about this in a bush. You might not even spot it. So spider webs also help to camouflage something like this. Now they're tiny, tiny, a blue waxbill is only about this big. So it's a tiny little bird, like a little tiny finch, and lays its tiny little eggs in this pouch itself. So how cool is that? Birds are amazing creatures. There is so much to learn. Let me put down, did a big full circle there for no reason. Let me put that nest down. For example, I just saw, can I find it again? Yes, I can. In my bird book, there is a gorgeous feather that changes color depending on how the light hits it. So there you go. You see how that's changing color? It's difficult to see because all of a sudden the clouds have come out. See, it goes from blue to black and blue to black. Now, it's hard to see because the clouds have come in, so the light isn't that clear. But how cool is that? Changing, changing. Beautiful. So birds are fascinating to learn more about. Let me put it back in the book so we don't lose it. Now, Henry, you want to know if there are birds. Ooh, that was appropriate on that page. You want to know if there are birds that ever fight with each other. Yes, there are. These are a really good example. Different species of birds, different types of cuckoos, and they do fight with each other. Why do you think they might fight with each other? Does anybody know what a cuckoo does? Well, a cuckoo is a naughty, naughty bird, because a cuckoo, and there's lots of different types of cuckoo. Some are big. This is one that we see quite a lot on our drives. Some are big, some are small. And what they do is they will go and lay their eggs in another bird's nest. So they don't bother to raise their own babies, they make another bird do it. Which seems a little bit lazy, doesn't it? But it's not lazy, it's just the way that cuckoos work. Then there are different types of eagles that will fight with each other for space. They might fight over food. Vultures fight over food all the time. Fight over food. It was difficult to say. Vultures fight over food all the time. And it's not just birds out here, and there's more birds that fight, but I can't go into all of them at the moment because Taylor's creature might just run away. So let's go and have a look quickly.
Look at this beautiful big warthog that we spotted. He was on his knees munching away, eating delicious grass and grass roots. But he is a old, big old male. Look at him, he's so big. He's probably been around for many, many years. And I know you were, a lot of you were asking earlier about, would you go up to an animal that wasn't dangerous? Now, even though a warthog is a vegetarian and eats grass and will feed on fruit and a variety of other things, you've got to be very, very careful of these big warthogs, because you're about to see he's going to walk past a very big termite mound. And they will live in old burrows that an animal called an aardvark or an anteater would have created. And they reverse into these big holes. So that's where they go to sleep. So they're only around during the day, and then when the sun starts to go down, they reverse into their burrows and they go to bed. And the reason why they reverse into the burrows is so that, and hopefully he'll come out and pop his head out for us. And we'll see he's got very big tusks. And that is so that when he goes running out of his burrow very quickly, if a lion or a leopard comes to try and eat him, he can fight them with those tusks. Now, Jen, you're actually wondering, how sharp are those tusks? You know, Jen, I think that they would hurt you very much. And I have found many warthog skulls out here, because the leopards like to eat them. The lions also like to eat them. And anything will eat a warthog, really. And I've found a skull with very, very big tusks before. And they were extremely sharp. So you want to be very, very careful. But the thing that will hurt you the most is when this warthog is running at full speed. Because he doesn't look like much now. But he probably weighs, this one easily, about 95 pounds. Maybe even over 100 pounds. He's a big boy. And they can get massive. We once found a warthog, and he weighed about 120, probably even maybe between 120 and 140 pounds. He was a monster. He was as tall as me, as long as what I am. Now, Keaton, you were wondering, I don't even know what you were wondering. I've forgotten what you were wondering. You were wondering, how long do they live? Sorry, Keaton. For a minute there, I stopped concentrating and I couldn't remember. Now, they can live for quite a number of years. Unfortunately, though, I think the oldest ones don't get more than about 15 years old. I think that would be quite, or maybe actually, maybe I lie, maybe a little bit older than that. But the animals don't normally get too old out here, unfortunately. We're going to carry on looking for this leopard as well, because of all the predators that are out and about here. And the older you get out in the bush, the weaker you get, the less you eat, and the easier of a target you become for a lion, a leopard, a hyena, even a cheetah. Now, Ethan, you've asked a very interesting question. You're wondering if the warthogs will eat the termites. I've never seen a warthog eating a termite. I'm not sure if they would. Maybe if they were absolutely desperate, because I know that Pumbaa from The Lion King, it shows that he likes to eat lots and lots of insects. But warthogs actually use their nose very much like the snout of a pig, but it's very hard on top. And they go down onto their knees and they sort of push their heads on the ground and lift up all the grass. And they can also be a big pest to farmers in South Africa, because they will ruin crops and open grasslands and fields. They will destroy them in a matter of days, because they live in families. But he seems to be all on his own. So no, I don't think that they will eat termites. I think if where they can, they'll eat fruits and grasses. But in the winter months, when there's nothing out and about, I wouldn't push it past a warthog. Oh, I can hear the ghost bird again. Let's see if we can hear it calling for real and not me making the call. So we have to sit and listen Hey, isn't it so quiet? And of course, this is what normally happens, is when you want a bird to make a call, it doesn't. And it sits you. But that's okay, at least we got to see it. Normally we just hear them. I'd much rather, like we did, actually see the bird. So we're just going around and around. We're coming up to one of the boundaries now. So we've got areas where we can drive around on. And we want to just check this boundary road to perhaps see if those little leopard cubs maybe didn't go on a walkabout and cross out of our traversing area. Now, Evie has been driving far and wide and he's managed to get all the way towards a cheetah plains. So let's go take a look at what cheetah plains looks like.
Cheetah plains have been quiet so far. We've just gone past the Mala Mala. We've just gone past the Mala Mala boundary and it's nothing to speak of as of yet. I'm gonna go check the Kruger boundary, see if there's anything that wants to come in or that has come in already. See if we can find something to follow up on. Let's see what the afternoon is gonna bring. So Noah, you'd like to know how the summer season affects the animals. When it's very hot, they tend to try and hide away and stick into cooler, thicker, shaded areas. So then you only start getting movement from these guys a lot later on. But other than that, I think it's all up to us to find them. They're always here. They don't disappear. Excuse me. Thank you. So yeah, they don't disappear or go anywhere else. The animals are always here. It's just where they'll be and where we'll find them. And then one of the other things to consider in the dry season, there's a lot less foliage, so there's a lot less leaves and grass. So you can see a little bit further into the bush. That makes our lives a bit easier. But yeah, I think it all comes down to luck and if and when these guys want to show themselves. Oh. Garden services. The elephants have been very nice to us and decided to push this tree over the road. Let's just quickly get around it. Just having a good look at tracks. We're on the Kruger boundary now, so just want to make sure there's nothing that's crossed in, or if anything has crossed in. Maybe a nice herd of buffalo moving towards water or something. That'll be nice to see again, as a nice herd of buffalo. I think the last herd we saw was that distraught one with the lions hunting. Excuse me. Excuse me. Well, let's try and see if we can find anything this side. But there's a wildebeest. Lone male wildebeest. Sure. Where are all your friends, sir? Territorial male. I wonder if that's the same guy that hangs out on that big open area on the boundary. I wonder. I wonder where that herd's gone that's on. we've seen a couple of times. Looks like he's disappearing into some thicker bush. In the meantime, let's try and see if we can find some more stuff. But yeah, let's go see what Jamie is up to in the tent.
I'm just sitting in the tent and marveling at all of the amazing things that we have to show you out here, and just wishing that I had more time to spend with the students of Kingston Elementary. But unfortunately, our safari with you is drawing to a close. But before you have to disappear off, let's go and have a quick look at the creatures that are on the dam camera. So there you go, a group of dwarf mongoose. And when you pop back into the tent, I'll show you exactly why they are called dwarf mongoose. But similar to something like a pine marten or a ferret, a mongoose is a very, very sweet animal, and we get different types of mongoose. Now, a little bit earlier, all of them were out around the termite mound, and this camera that you're looking through is sort of situated right at a waterhole, and we've become very, very familiar with this particular family of dwarf mongoose. Now, some species of mongoose are solitary, so you never see them in groups, and some are sociable and actually have these amazingly complex social systems. Now, how many of you have ever heard of a meerkat? Now, a meerkat or a suri cat, you won't see one out here because they are desert-dwelling animals. But the little dwarf mongoose that we get here are very, very similar to them. And they have the most fascinating family structure. So a dwarf mongoose is led by an alpha male and an alpha female, kind of like wolves. You can see, look at them. Look at the ones on the right. They've seen something. And the one at the bottom with its head sticking out is alarm calling. We can't hear them because I'm busy talking to you, but there is one at the bottom alarm calling, making a little chuk. That was a terrible mongoose impression. I'm so sorry. I'm not very good at doing dwarf mongoose impressions, but you can see something has really got their attention. Now, when you're this as small as a dwarf mongoose, absolutely anything could be a threat. It could be an eagle. It could be a snake. It could even be a very, very large lizard known as a Legavan or a monitor lizard. So there's something there that has made them on alert. But luckily, the advantage of being a dwarf mongoose, of course, is that there are lots and lots of eyes to keep an eye on what is going on around them. And as soon as one sees something, it will start alarm calling and calling to the rest of the group, and they'll all gather together in a safe spot. And what the little holes that they are sort of curled up in, that is a termite mound, an old termite mound. So those tunnels go right deep underneath the ground, and they travel through and connect to each other. See how they're all gathered together? There's some on the left of the termite mound as well. Right, now, what are they looking at? What have they seen? The ones on the right have not stopped looking in that direction. What could be there? Could it be a bird? Could it be a lizard or a snake? Something's got them on edge and upset. I'm going to keep watching the little mongoose and see what they get up to. What are you going to do, little mongoose? We'll have to try and figure out what startled them. Now, I said I'd give you an idea of why they are called a dwarf mongoose. And that is because a dwarf mongoose, probably from the tip of its little nose to the tip of its little tail, is probably about this long. So for those of you with rulers in front of you, it's probably no more than about, give or take, just over 10 inches. So it's a tiny, tiny little dwarf mongoose. Oh, unfortunately, Kingston Elementary, I'm sure you've all been having so much fun, but it is time for us to say goodbye to you all. So I hope that you enjoyed your time with us and that we'll see you on safari soon. I also hope that you have a lovely school day further. Bye-bye, everybody. Now, for our regular viewers, you're not going anywhere, so don't fear, you are still with us. For our new viewers, we do often start off our safari with a school session in order to chat to the different schools, but you can send through your questions, and please do. We'll now be taking your questions on #SafariLive on Twitter, or email through to questions@wildearth.tv, and we'd love to hear from you, so please do send those through. Right, I'm sure you're all very keen to get a slightly different perspective on this whole world. We started off off our sunset safari with a view from the air, let's go and have another look at where Connor is flying and what he is seeing. So just look at that. You can see the network of roads crisscrossing across the reserve. And of course, most obvious, you can have a look. Oh, there's the pump house. We've just flown over the pump house. Now, that is where the leopard cubs were. So we're on Twin Dams now, and we're busy searching or trying to help to search for those leopards. So Connor is our eye in the sky to try and figure out where those little leopard cubs have gone. And we're just double-checking all of the places they were. We could also, of course, see their mom. Now, you'd have to be particularly sharp-eyed to spot a leopard, but it gives you an idea of the type of area that these leopards are hiding in. Very, very dense vegetation. Excuse me. While I recover myself, let's send you over to Taylor.
So we've come back towards Twin Dams now to have a little look around to perhaps see if Hosanna hasn't wandered down to his favorite little pan. But sadly, they're not here. But we've found something else to show you. Look at who we've got lurking in the water. Now that is a water monitor. How cool is that? Sitting there, not a particularly big one. Just trying to keep cool for the day. Yes, that's right. That's English is all right, I think. Now, we've been seeing a lot of rock monitors around, and they're not quite as colorful as the water monitors. You can see this one's got quite a bit of yellow on it. And it doesn't have as square of a face. It doesn't quite look like Godzilla. Now, sorry, Herbie's just trying to get hold of me. Go, Herbie. Standing by. Herbert, I'm standing by. I'm on Twin Dams. Okay, never mind, sorry. I thought Herbie was going to tell me that he had the leopards, but no, I'm very sad. But that is a beautiful little water monitor, of course. Very small. They normally get quite big. They can get over 8 foot, can you believe that? But that little guy has still got quite a bit of growing to do. And I'd be careful sitting out in the water like that, because a martial eagle will find that a tasty snack. And we've been of course, seeing them feasting upon the water monitor and the rock monitors quite recently. So what we're going to do now is I'm going to carry on driving, looking around you, but we're going to take a different sort of view. You're going to start looking at me from the sky. We're driving over the dam wall now. I don't know what road this is, but we're going to jump onto it. Oh, it's the fire break. Okay, we won't go down the fire break because I saw another vehicle there. You can see all those pans are nice and full as well, which is quite good. But if this weather continues, this heat continues, they're going to keep drying up very, very quickly. Ooh, sorry, I'm also stopping and looking because I've just picked up on some of their old lion tracks. Never mind. You won't be able to see them from up at the top of the sky, though. It's a little bit too high for all of you. But I just spotted where I braked very briefly. Now, there's lots and lots of clouds. You can see that they're burning out. There's a couple of dark ones though, but nothing that really looks like rain. It seems as though we might only get rain in a couple of days time, which is fantastic because that's going to keep the bush nice and green like it is at the moment. And that's what we want. We want the pans to stay full. We want the grass to keep growing as the animals are munching away on it. And hopefully this vegetation will stay lush like this for a couple more months before winter dawns over us, and well, then everything goes brown and yellow again and it looks like a desert. So let's keep our fingers crossed, and let me know if you've spotted any elephants from all the way at the top of the sky. You can hashtag Safari Live and say where you saw them or how many you saw, if you saw any cool animals as Connor's flying. as Connor is flying above us, you'll see me darting and diving underneath some of the trees that have formed canopies over the tops of the roads. We're moving along a drainage line, so you'll notice that it gets much thicker now, rather than, for instance, if we're out in the open. And if you look very carefully, you should actually be able to see a small part of the drainage line. But we're going to head sort of back towards in a westerly direction. And we're just going to keep checking along these drainage lines. Now, you saw some baboons earlier with Evie, and I'm not sure if it was the same troop. But as we've been driving along these roads where we think Shongile and Hosana sort of have been playing around for most of the day, all the baboon tracks go in through that area. Now, two little cubs like that wouldn't be very threatening to a troop of baboons that are at least 30 strong. So they probably chase them around a bit. But there's good news. The tracks don't go over a Gowrie mane, so that's important, which means that they're probably still somewhere between Treehouse Dam and the pump on Philemon's cutline, Philemon's dip. But now where they are, I'm not sure. It's been very hot, so they could also just be curled up underneath the tree or maybe hiding behind some marula leaves. That's why we've got to keep checking everywhere, up, down on the ground, looking for footprints, looking for a tail dangling off a branch. It can be quite a tricky situation to get yourself in when you are tracking animals. It takes a lot of concentration. And you'll see I keep leaning over every now and then, which is nice that we don't actually have the doors anymore, because that means I can look right out next to me and not have too many obstructions. See, here's a kudu. We'll see if I can get a view for you. It's a bit difficult because it's hiding behind the trees, as you can see. And it is a young male kudu. Oh, David, there's actually an entire family of kudu just walking a little bit further to the right on the bank. If you keep going right, David, yeah, you've got them there. They're also hiding behind all of the trees, unfortunately. But that's where kudu like to live. Is they prefer this thicker vegetation, as most of you know, but as most of you do know as well, we have lots of new viewers always watching the show. So you can see that they've got ginormous ears, which allows them to hear something like a leopard moving through the bush. But sometimes that's actually just not good enough. The leopards are able to sneak up and catch a young kudu. Isn't that wonderful? Rightio, Evie is scouring the plains on, well, cheetah plains, and hopefully he gets lucky and finds those cheetah brothers. I know that's what he's set out for this afternoon, so we wish him all the best. Let's go see how his hunt is doing.
Sounds like Taylor's having some good luck this afternoon. Sounds like you've been having some good fun with her. The plains of Cheetah Plains have been very quiet. Yeah, I think there's one or two more places that we want to check, and then we're going to head over to Chitwa. Yeah, there's hardly any game activity at the moment. I wonder where everyone's decided to either hide or move on. Let's see if there's anything around the water here. We had three in a row pans at the moment. Not even a track of anything coming for a drink. Barbara, you are asking if we've had any sightings of wild dogs recently. Not that I'm aware of. I think there was a quick one a couple of days ago. But not that I'm aware of any good wild dog sightings recently. That'll be nice if someone decides to just jump up and show themselves. Just got a vehicle passing us. Hello, how are you, mate?
Thanks for yourself.
Lekker, man. We'll see you later.
Any luck, man?
Not yet. We're working on it. Enjoy. Just saying hello. Come on, animals, decide to show yourselves. Ryan, I think we must slowly start heading back in the westerly direction. What do you think? Start our own little migration back to the west. Alright, well, we're gonna keep moving back west. In the meantime, let's go see what Jamie is up to in the tent.
I'm playing with the baboon skull, and I have done a terrible thing, and now I can't get it back together again. Oh no. Oh dear. Here we go. I actually picked it up in answer to Mike's question. Now, Mike wanted to know how it was that we got the bones in the tent so white. And the answer is we didn't do anything to them. Now, a number of these skulls have been professionally prepared, and there's a number of techniques in order to do so, in order to prepare something like a skeleton, in order for it to be displayed. But most of the bones that we get out here, that we have picked up, done it all wrong. James is going to shout at me. There we go. I'll just put you back here where I can't break you. A lot of the bones, like for example, Gerald the giraffe skull, has been... James is definitely going to shout at me. Just pretend I didn't just throw his water bottle out of the window. Okay, we'll move on rapidly. A lot of the bones that we have found have just been found. And they've just rotted. Most of it has just rotted away. This buffalo leg, for example, is kind of gross. It still has a little bit of the soft tissue and the tendon connections and the muscles and so on plastered around it. But if we were to chuck this outside and leave it for long enough, it would eventually disappear. And that's through a number of different methods, whether it is from beetles, carrion beetles, different types of larvae that get into the bones themselves. Generally, bacteria as well will break it down. Fungus, you get a lot of a decomposing fungus or decomposer funguses, fungi, goodness gracious, that will help to clean off a bone if you leave it out in the wild for long enough. That's not always an option though, because if you are really looking for a nice skeleton for display purposes and you found the perfect one, there is a very, very good chance that there is a creature that is going to come by and ruin all your hopes and dreams by chewing upon it. And that, of course, is a hyena, because they will come through and chew on bones even if they are not actually... even if there's no meat on them, there's no nutritional value, they just kind of like to chew, like dogs with a bone, testing their jaw strength and so on. I don't know why that needed a demonstration, but anyway, so they'll come and chew it. So sometimes you need to rescue bones in order to prepare them for educational purposes like this. Now, many years ago, my friend Emma and I started a display cabinet just like this, but complete with all kinds of things, with cards, with information about it. And one of the things that we encountered was a carcass of a 3-day-old lion that had been killed in a lion fight. But there were no major injuries or damage done. But of course, we wanted to get there before the hyenas did. It is a serious, serious business. If you're interested in preparing bones, it takes a lot of work and it takes a lot of research into it. We ended up doing the wrong thing in that we boiled the bones and then we poured bleach in because we were just so desperate. It had been in the sun for 3 days. I don't need to describe to you what it was like. I think you can just let your imagination do the work for you. But we ended up boiling it and then pouring bleach in. Now, what bleach does is it softens the bones. Ideally, what you'd like to do is put it in underneath the surface of the ground and let the insects do the work for you, or perhaps as we did once with an eland skull, which was gross, to tie it in a tree out of reach of hyenas, although there's always the risk that a leopard will find it out here. So there's different methods. The internet has a vast, if you're interested in doing something like that, vast, vast, vast network of knowledge about the best ways. Peroxide, for example, something that might not soften the bones, a way of preparing the bones and preparing them for a display cabinet just like this one. Excuse me. I'm so sorry. I'm actually feeling loads better today. Sorry, cursed. Actually, no, I'm not sorry, cursed. I'm a bit sorry, cursed. I'm going to take a sip of water quickly and try and contain the coughs. Right. just don't breathe too deeply. Right, so some of you who are sharp-eyed may have noticed that I've put something underneath the microscope. Now, I'm tossing up an idea here. It is so interesting. I'm fascinated by it. I've never done this before, and I've never ever seen this before. It is a leaf. So perhaps I should show you. I'm so sorry. Let me show you first the shape of the leaf. I have got a branch here as well that belongs to this particular leaf. And I wonder, I'm thinking about giving this to you as a nearly impossible tree quiz. Should I do it? Is this too difficult? I'm inclined to say this is not too difficult for some of you. Some of you are absolutely amazing with your tree and your bird IDing skills. And I thought perhaps you might find this fascinating in terms of what leaf, what tree this leaf belongs to. So it does feel very, very rough on your fingers. And if we have a look at what it looks like under the microscope, look how incredible this is. This is what makes it feel rough. And I mean, you would never know to look at it that those things were on there. And I'm completely fascinated to see this. I really, truly am. It is incredible. Look at these little star-shaped. It almost looks like a cactus, doesn't it? These tiny little star-shaped protrusions. Oh, let me just not even try. Put the stick under the microscope because I'm shaking from my cough. Look at them. That's sort of, now I've always thought about sort of protrusions or hairs on leaves as being a way of avoiding water loss from the plant, but perhaps this one serves a different purpose. Now it might not work for something like an elephant or a giraffe, although I don't think it would be particularly pleasant for them to eat either. But perhaps something like a caterpillar maybe would decide that it didn't want to eat something like that. So, a nearly impossible tree quiz. I'm going to give it to you. A nearly impossible tree quiz. What tree does that leaf belong to? And to make it, should I make it easier? Some of you are so good now at your trees. To make it slightly easier, it's referred to as a bush rather than a tree, but you would find it in any tree reference book out here. Which particular species is it? Fascinating. Would I get that? If I obviously went and plucked the leaf from one of the surrounding bushes, would I have got that if somebody put that under the microscope and said, what is it? I'm not sure. So I will be very impressed with you. Now, Aisa, you say an apple leaf tree. It's not a bad guess at all because the color is very, very similar. However, it is not an apple leaf tree. And what I'll do is, at some point I will go because there are apple... Stay there. There are apple leaves in the vicinity, so I'll go and I'll grab one of them and I will bring it and put it underneath the microscope. And I'll do the same with the silver cluster leaf, because of course the silver cluster leaf is called the silver cluster leaf because it has silver hairs on the base. Oh, I've told you already what it's not. Drat. So very, very good guess, but it is not an apple leaf. I'm going to let you ponder over that while we go over to Taylor and find out what she's pondering over.
Still searching for the leopard cubs. I don't know where they are. None of us can find them between myself, Herbert and Rexon for the moment. So I think what's happened is I think that they've been chased somewhere and are now sleeping in a very dense thicket somewhere, just keeping out of the sun. And that could be anywhere really, because these little cubs probably would have run for their lives if a big troop of baboons came through. Especially if mom wasn't around to protect them and try and chase off of the adult baboons. So that would have been really their only defense. So we're going to keep checking. We're actually going towards Chele Pan now. We're on pangolin track. We're going to check these little mud wallows along the way, see if anything's come for a drink. Maybe some zebras will be around. Maybe elephants. I wouldn't mind seeing some elephants this afternoon as well. And if we don't get any luck over here, we'll probably go and try and follow up on where we had those in Kahumas this morning and see if they are still sitting under some aguari trees shading themselves. But we'll only be able to find that out once we check two more roads. And then I think that we've put in a good effort, and hopefully if Rexon or Herbert do find the leopards, they'll let us know and we'll be able to come back this way. But it's difficult now, and this is the problem that we're going to have with the vegetation getting so thick. is that the sightings of the animals are going to become more and more difficult. But nothing has come to drink. Not even a terrapin. Just a couple of little splitters and splatters on the water. There's a butterfly, an African vagrant. You can see it flapping its wings and flying around, avoiding the screen. But that's all. And even the butterflies now. Ooh, warthogs with babies. Let's see if we can get a view. They've just disappeared around the corner. Don't run, don't run. Don't run, babies. Can you see them in there, David? There we go. There they are. Run, little piggies, run. No, don't run. No, I mean, stay, little piggies, stay. I made a mistake. I didn't want to chase them away. Hello, Mom keeping a very close eye on us. There's a little bum. Help us, Mom, help us. Oh, sorry, you know what? I just had a fly trying to sneak under my hat. How dare it? So that was me trying to flick it away. Here we go. Mom goes. 1, 2, 3, little, 4, 5. 5 little baby bums. 6 little baby, 7 little baby bums. Come on, round it up to an even number. Nope. It doesn't look like there are 8 little piglets. That's the most piglets. No, that's an adult. I got excited. I was going to shout 8. But that is the most little pigs that I've seen since I've been here. We're normally only seeing 1 or 2. And Kirstie said that this is perhaps the same warthogs that you saw earlier with Evia. It could possibly, definitely be so. Aren't they so sweet? Oh, I wish they would have come out into the open. And I'm sure they're hanging around on Pangolin Track. It's a good road if you're a warthog or an animal that likes to wallow, as you just saw those beautiful big mud wallows just before we spotted the little warthogs. And there they go. Wonderful. That's fantastic. I love this road. Oh no, look what's in front of us. This is just amazing. Look at this crazy looking red-billed hornbill. Looks a little bit deranged. I always think the red-billed hornbills, especially with that black streak of feathers that stands up a little bit, it makes them look a bit mad. And it was having a dust bath in the middle of the road. And now it's stopped for a snack. It looks like it's looking for something to eat. What have you spotted? No. Itchy hornbill. He keeps looking down onto the ground. Perhaps there's little termites or beetles or ants moving around there, and that's what it's looking for. But I was hoping it was going to come back under the road. It's because, you see, we were watching the warthogs and we weren't paying the hornbill any attention, so it made the quick opportunity to quickly get as much dust on its body as it could. Let's see, is it going to come out again? I really want it to come out, because to see a bird dust bathing is not as common as what everybody thinks. Oh, and apparently it's National Bird Day in the USA. Well, congratulations, and isn't this wonderful that we're seeing so many different birds? That explains the luck we had with the the male and female orange-breasted bushrike and the quick glimpse of the grey-headed bushrike. That makes perfect sense. And of course, now we've got a red-billed hornbill munching away. It actually looked like it was eating a cricket or maybe even a grasshopper, one of the two. There's been a couple of crickets around at the moment as well. Look at it. Mouth open, it's a little bit hot. And searching very carefully. Actually, you know who that reminds me of? That reminds me of Jane when he looks for insects in the plants on a bush walk. Don't you think? Don't you think that looks like just like James? Checking every leaf, turning over all the logs, making sure it doesn't miss anything. Except, well, James doesn't really eat the insects afterwards, though, unlike this hornbill. He just collects them, shows you, and then releases them again. This is a very obliging little hornbill. And I think that that's sensible, as it's moved into the shade now. You can see it's not so hot anymore. Isn't this funny? What have you spotted? Come on, catch another grasshopper for us. Now doing a balancing act on a fallen branch, though. Very good at balancing. Oh, on the smaller one now. And back down it goes again. Doesn't look like it's having much luck in this area. Maybe it's feeling the pressure as we are watching it. Come on. Catch one more for us and then we will leave you alone. One more grasshopper. Maybe you can, he'll use that as motivation. No, not going to catch any more. Right, let's carry on. Let's keep checking our last two roads in search of the leopards and then we're going to go. Now, James, you're wondering if there are any birds that I'd like to see in the that are from the USA. I'd like to see a blue jay or something along those lines. That would be quite a nice one to see. Oh, here's Herbie. Let's chat to Herbie. I think, and then I got to see a lot of the vultures, the turkey vultures and things were really funny. They were quite cool to see. Let's chat to Herbs. Hi, Herbie. Have you having any luck?
Not yet.
There's Herbert. No luck yet?
Yeah.
Okay. Yet. I think I'm going to go and maybe try and follow up on those lions.
What about, did they manage to relocate?
Oh, did they?
Yeah, there was a report.
Okay, perfect. I shall go and have a scratch around for them. And hopefully we find these leopards a little bit later.
Okay, I'll go back to
it. Okay, thanks so much, Herbie. Rightio, off we go. For those of you who have just heard the name Herbert all through the start of the show, that's Herbert. And Herbert, of course, he's very important. He helps us find lots of the animals. And then, of course, he makes you feel very safe when you're out walking about as well. But it doesn't look like anything else has come towards these pans to come and have a drink. So we're going to, I think, go and follow up on the lions and see where they are. So off you go to Evia and some Inyala.
Hey, awesome. Yo, Chitwa is already helping us a lot. There's some beautiful Nyala around. Yeah, lovely, lovely, lovely. So there's just a lot of chat on the radio. I think I might have a nice surprise for you a bit later on. So we're going to just keep the suspense going a tiny bit. But yeah, let's spend some time with these beautiful Nyala. See what surprises we'll bring later on. It's a nice size herd, 3 or 4, 5. Looks like 5 adult females and a couple of younger females. I don't see any males around. Yeah, very nice to see. I'm standing by. I think I'm just somewhere to the south of your lock. So I'm just chatting to the guys that are with your surprise at the moment. So let's hear what they are going to tell me and see if we're going to get our chance to go have a look. So with the family of spiraled horned antelope, we've got the Nyala, Bushbuck, Kudu in our area that we see regularly. But from Nyala smaller, Nyala and Bushbuck, they've got spots on their bodies as well. Not only the stripes running down their bodies, you can see on the back legs there, those beautiful spots. And that all just helps with camouflage and getting them to blend in with the bush. My understanding of these stripes is that it breaks the animal up, gives that illusion of open space. The white gives that illusion of open space around. There's a male that's going to join us. Still quite far into the bush, but he's coming in. You see the male there, Brian? There we go. Good afternoon, sir. And you can see he's got a massive mohawk on his back, trying to impress those ladies. Trying to show how big and strong he is by doing that. And there's a very good chance that female, there we go, we're going to see the phlegm and grimace. He's going to try and pick up if she's in estrus or not. Oh, there we go, the lip curl. Testing a bit more. If he carries on, there's nothing to excite him there. I think he's going to go past all these different females in this group and test readiness for mating. I'm just going to chat to these guys again on the radio. Yes, anyway. Yeah, I'm further south of that. It's the first road that goes south away from, on the western side of the airstrip. Oh, that's female number four, number five already that it's testing now. That is spectacular. Copy, thank you. I'll try and figure it out now. Yeah, this is amazing to see. It's lovely interaction between the males and the female. I just need to study the map. It sounds like we can start making our way towards our surprise, but I need to figure out where exactly it is. One of the beauties of exploring new areas, you're going to get lost every now and then. It would have been quite entertaining to see if there was another male around as well. The dance that they do. Carol, you would like to know why we don't see a huge amount of bushbuck around. They're just quite secretive and like certain areas, so very thick bush around drainage lines, not in out in the open as the others so much. So yeah, you have to go into certain areas to try and find them. We see quite a lot of bushbuck around our camp at the DRC. They like that area. There's nice water, it's nice and thick in the vicinity of the camp, so folks, let's leave these Nyala in peace. Let's try and find that surprise for you. We'll see you a bit later. And let's go see what Jamie is up to.
My goodness me, that was one very determined Nyala. Now, it's not often I sit on the side where I don't know what the surprise is, so I'm very curious to see what FW has up his sleeve. But while we wait for him to get there, let's go and have a look at the amazing shot that Connor has managed to procure for you from the skies. I won't cough this time, I promise. Now, look at that. Now, that is some serious skill that our wonderful pilot Connor is showing us over there. A dead tree that Connor is circling around. Of course, one of the most atmospheric things to film, particularly over sunset and sunrise. And then if you look very closely, that looks like one of our Wahlberg's eagles perched in the boughs of this tree. I think it's a Wahlberg's. That's what it is. It looks like one of our pale morphs or one of Mr. or Mrs. Wahlbergs. Either Mr. or Mrs. Wahlbergs. This is amazing. Just look at that. You've got a really, really amazing idea of what kind of a view these birds will have from the top of the tree. Now, this is not something we can show you on the vehicles. It's, oh my goodness, Connor, that was brave. Does anyone else feel slightly nervous? Oh, this is a perspective we can't really get you on the bushwalk or from the vehicles. This is absolutely incredible. Definitely one of Mr. or Mrs. Wahlbergs. I can see quarantine clearings in the background. What a phenomenal view. Just look at that. Hello, beautiful. It won't be long now till Connor's basically living with the birds each and every day. Just to give you some perspective, there we go, the beautiful, sort of partly cloudy blue skies and the vast wilderness that stretches out beyond that. Somewhere there in the shot you're seeing drives FW, I'm not quite sure where Taylor is. And the perfect vantage point for an eagle, there's no leaves on that tree, so it doesn't have to worry about tangling itself up in them. That is so cool. Unbelievably impressed with Connor's amazing flying abilities there. And speaking about being very, very impressed, I am very, very impressed with all of you. Particularly, I Walk in the Rain and Heidi. You two both got the tree quiz right. Very, very, very well done to you. It was a tricky one, and it wasn't really fair exactly, because I didn't give you much to go on. Just the size of the leaf, the shape of the leaf, and of course that roughness. So both I Walk in the Rain and Heidi guessed that it was the sandpaper raisin bush. Now, if you did guess that at home, and perhaps I haven't mentioned your name, well done to you as well. So it is the sandpaper raisin bush, this leaf that we were looking at. So if we go and have a look again on the microscope, those fine little star-shaped hairs are the things that give it its name, the sandpaper raisin. So there you go. It's also known in English as the square-stemmed raisin. And the square-stemmed raisin, I've been told, has a local use. Now, it's called a square-stemmed raisin because the stems are square. They're not round like most trees. They're square, almost kind of like a sedge in a way. Sedges have edges, as the rhyme goes when you're learning different plants, when you're guiding. Sedges have edges. Excuse me. Right, so, I promised I wouldn't cough, I'm trying not to. So, one of the things that square paper raisin bushes are used for, oh, I picked a green one, that was very silly. The idea, I've been told, never had this happen to me, just to clarify, but the idea is that it can be used as a form of corporal punishment or as initiation. So essentially what they'll do, I don't know why it has to be a square-stemmed raisin, I imagine just the edges make it that much more grueling, but essentially it can be used as a form of punishment or, oh dear, I broke it. Oh dear, oh well, we'll go with the two that we have. So essentially, the idea is, with a naughty child, or perhaps a child that is being initiated as becoming a man, it wouldn't have happened to the girls in this situation, but to become a man, well, essentially what would happen is the child would hold its hands like this, in certain local cultures around South Africa, hold it, because this plant grows everywhere. Hold your hands like this. There'd be one here as well, but I broke the last one. And your fingers are then squeezed together by another person's hand. So essentially they come through, they wrap their hands around yours, or the child's, and they squeeze it together. And any sign of pain, any kind of grimace or anything, and then the initiation is not completed. But it can also be used as a punishment. Square-stemmed raisin, because it's got square stems, I guess the edges do hurt a little bit more. But I'm pretty sure that would hurt no matter what tree you use. So there you go, the square-stemmed raisin bush. Oh my goodness, Connor is on a roll this afternoon. Let's go and have a look at the nyala that he has found. Excuse me. Right, so there are nyala, all grazing away peacefully in the herd. You saw that nyala with FW earlier, the bull that was particularly keen on checking to see whether any of the females were ready to mate with him. I was going to No, I won't do it. No, I was going to make a joke about certain areas in Johannesburg that you can visit as a lady and might feel a little similar. Now, of course, you get the mixed herds. You can see there's some young males, some young females, all rejoicing in the fact that the grasses are fresh and green and juicy, and they no longer have to try and eke out a living eating things like sandpaper raisin bushes rather than the more succulent leaves of the young knobthorns and other growing trees. Oh my goodness, look, you see, that bull's causing trouble again. Leave them alone, mister. They're not interested. In fact, one of them is still a baby. She's still far too young. No, she's not interested. She's a he, mister. You're definitely barking up the wrong tree there. He was just chasing that young male away. Not so much checking out the female as checking out the competition. So obviously Nyala breed all year round, and that's why we're seeing such interesting dynamics with the Nyala bulls. There's the waterhole of Jumapan, and as we face south, the road of Twin Dams. That is beautiful. I did also promise that we were going to have a look at some of the other leaves under the microscope, and we will get round to that, I promise. But I'm sure you're all curious to head back onto the vehicle, so let's go and have a look and see what Taylor's up to.
So the lions haven't moved at all today. I thought that they would have perhaps gotten up a little bit later after we'd left them and maybe crossed the boundary, but luckily for us they didn't. They are still here for another afternoon, and it seems as though the sun has got the better of the Nkuhumas, because they are still fast asleep tucked away underneath all the gwari trees. And I think that they've moved just a couple of feet. They really haven't moved far at all. This is actually where we saw that we left the lionesses. They were right in the spot. And it seems as though the cubs have also got up from their original spot and just moved closer to the adults. Now, I think as far as Mike said, he says there is a male around here, probably lurking or just sleeping a little bit of a way away from the rest of the pride. And I'm still not sure where those other two lionesses are, where they've disappeared to. But we'll keep an eye out for them, of course. But for now, they're really hiding amongst some of the thick vegetation. You can see we are looking desperately through the branches of a quarry tree. And this is the view, unfortunately, we're going to have. It's not always glitz and glamour and perfect screenshots. And this is what makes it so fun, is that some days you get a better view than others. And well, on hot days like this, you can't really blame the lions for sleeping and tucking themselves away underneath all of these trees. I think that's a little floppy-eared girl that just gave us a big stretch to the left. There we go. Looks like it. She looks a little bit mangy, and then her ears look quite swollen as well. No one can still see her tail. It's terrible. Oh no, it actually looks like it's getting maybe a little bit more hair on it. The last time we saw it was almost completely bald. Remember, it looked like baboon's tail, the plant. But now, maybe it's healing a bit better. And we didn't really get a good view of her this morning because she was cuddled up to all of her brothers and sisters. So I'm not sure how well the manger's healing on her stomach, but it was very bad at one point. But again, all that dappled light coming through, and it's hot. I'm surprised that that lioness hasn't moved. And maybe they'll do exactly what happened this morning, as I said that. They'll get up and move now. No. No. They look like they are going to be here for quite some time. And that's the only problem going into summer, is not only does it become more and more difficult to spot the animals through the vegetation, as we are seeing now, but also because the days are so much longer and they're so much hotter, things like the cats, unfortunately, aren't as active as what they are in the winter months. They'll be sleeping for longer during the day under the shade of the trees. And only once the sun goes down and it gets a little bit cooler will they start to move around. It seems like Mike is actually leaving now, so we might try and steal his spot. We'll just wait for him to move out a little bit further. Here we go. That's perfect. That opens up a gap for us now.